to you, their new ambassador to El Salvador will be leaving shortly and take up his post there, Ambassador Vickery. And it's a photo op. It's a photo op.
Have you met the guerrillas on the run in El Salvador? Are you making progress?
It's a photo opportunity.
Thank you, Mr.
What about the black vest?
What?
What about the French? Are you disappointed they won't do more for Chad?
Photo op.
It's a photo opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
When can we see you?
I'm around all day, every day.
Well, where are the briefings?
Is that an invitation, sir?
Yes, we're very pleased to have him here, President Abou Diouf, the President of Senegal. Not here.
Can you talk about the French response? Has the French done enough, Mr. President?
Photo opportunity. Somebody's tagline. What did I interrupt? Or do you want to continue?
No, sir, I do not wish to continue.
Nothing would have happened if you'd have said yes. Well, listen, I'm glad to see you all over here to have a chance for a visit. And let me just take a few minutes here. And as you know, I'm off to Florida and Texas this week to seek support within the Hispanic community for our Central American policy and to emphasize the benefits of our domestic policies with regard to the community of Americans of Hispanic descent. And in the last few days, I've been meeting with some leaders. A few days ago, I met with 75 Hispanic supporters and leaders over in the dining room, and just a couple of days ago with several Hispanic leaders who are various professions, civil, legal, and educational. And this weekend, as a matter of fact, tomorrow, I'll be addressing the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce and the next day the GI Forum National Convention. And I am in El Paso, and I want to express my appreciation for all of you and for your dedicated service. I believe that communication is important, and we must take our programs, make them, our efforts known to the community at the local level. And that's not easy, because no matter what we do here, somehow the press usually finds something else to write and talk about than what we're doing here. And the positive effect, I think, of our economic program, while it was for all Americans, it certainly has had an effect on some of the problems in the community. The effect of tax rate cuts, the reduction of unemployment, in re-education, re-establishing the quality education idea with the changing the curriculum, doing something to inspire teachers to stay in the profession at all. And the Central American policy, which I know from the polls alone is the least understood of anything we're doing. The polls will come out with the majority is opposed to what we're doing and so forth. Then they ask a question and find that the greatest majority in the polls don't know which side we're on. And Saturday morning on my radio program, I'm going to try and explain again, if I can, in 5 minutes, whose side we're on. special assistant here, public liaison, Kathy Villalpando. She needs your support and expertise and suggestions so that we can reach the community better. And recently I've brought Joe Salgado from the Department of Justice to work in the presidential personnel so that we can have a better input in our recruiting of people from the Hispanic communities. Now, one last thing I want to say before I turn to you is I'm a little frustrated by the tendency of the press to psychoanalyze and tell you why you're doing things in public print. And of course, you've seen that everything I'm doing is all aimed that there's an election year coming, and therefore, belatedly, I am grandstanding and trying to invent things for political purposes. Well, it is frustrating, because the truth of the matter is, long before I ever thought I would have an opportunity such as this to do what was on my mind, I have long believed that this country of ours has never established the proper relationship that it should have with our neighbors here in the Americas. And that's why when I did have this opportunity and came to me before I was even inaugurated, I met the president then of Mexico at the border, and subsequently here after I was in office, and met with President Del Madrid. I'm going to meet with him again, but met with him before he took office, but after he'd been elected. And it's why early on I made a trip to South and Central America and met with leaders there. And the message was had to do with that dream of mine. I told him I knew about the various things that the United States had proposed and the ideas for better relations. I don't think they were ever properly followed up, but also I think the thing that was wrong with them is we're the big colossus of the North. And for us to suddenly say to our neighbors here in the Western Hemisphere, look, here is a plan, well, that's the big colossus, big brother speaking again. So in my trip to every leader I met with, I said, what are your ideas? How can we bring ourselves together as equal partners and allies in the Western Hemisphere and bring about the proper development of these two continents, and pointed out that from South Pole to North Pole, there's no place in the world like it. We all have the same pioneer heritage. We all worship the same God. We are all Americans. And I was surprised when I said that in some of those countries to find the reaction. They thought that we kind of grabbed off the name. Well, I pointed out you can't go around saying I'm the United States. But we are all Americans. Yes, we're different countries. Yes, we have our own diverse ways, and that's fine. Nothing wrong with these sovereign nations. But where else in the world can you cross the border into another nation and still find you're among Americans? We are all Americans, North, Central, and South. And what a force for good we could be with more than 600 million people in this Western Hemisphere, developing, helping each other, improving the economy, erasing those areas where there is extreme wealth and extreme poverty and no in-between. Opportunity for everybody. That's what it's all about, and I better quit talking now. Everett?
Well, Mr. President, in carrying out our function at the VA, we also have
see Neil at the racetrack, he and I fighting hard together.
He's a worse Republican than I am.
I tell you, he's a worse handicapper than I am. He's the worst.
Couple of minutes. We've got some questions.
We don't mind if you say something serious.
I never think of anything serious.
There we go. All right.
How are you, Mr. President?
Thank you. field. You used to have a gallery up there behind glass.
No, Neil is a racetrack pre-regular.
Leads me to believe that it's always on the golf course. Right now he's getting rid of the fishing.
By the way, I saw Tom Jones last week. He said Jack's feeling looking 100% better, rather. That's really good news.
But what's wrong with
him? That's just the malignancy he found. He's been getting terrible treatments for it.
My brother is my shield. He's still here.
Told me today, he was David, man. He's off the morning, going to the racetrack all our time. Wonderful.
Mr. President, are you at all concerned that the commission may turn into critics of your policy?
Not at all.
Why not?
Because we wanted a completely independent commission to find out something on a for a long-range policy, and they're going to remain independent.
Thank you. That's very
good. No. I thought that was very interesting.
All right. We're gathered here today for the public signing of legislation which proclaims September 3rd, 1983, a national day of celebration, marking the 200th anniversary of the signing of the Treaty of Paris. What the United States will observe on September 3rd, of course, is much more than the anniversary of a distant diplomatic agreement. In a real sense, the Treaty of Paris marked the moment when America became officially, or when it officially joined, the family of nations. A long and grueling war for independence had already been fought. Risking their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor, our ancestors had earned their freedom in the grim privation of Valley Forge and on far-flung battlefields throughout the 13 colonies. It's been a hard struggle, fought against what was then the mightiest empire on earth. Without the courage of our people and their dedication to freedom, and without the help of France, our oldest ally, we couldn't have prevailed. But on September 3rd, 1783, 8 years of heroic sacrifice met their just reward. The Treaty of Paris officially recognized the independence of those 13 infant states, born of pioneer strength and a vision of freedom, and opened a great new chapter in the history of the world. If July 4th, 1776 is the day when the American people, represented by the Continental Congress, declared their independence, September 3rd, 1783 is the day when our independence became an accomplished, recognized fact. The true birth of a nation forged in freedom and dedicated to a noble ideal that still inspires men and women everywhere. It's a special tribute to the great venture that is America that in the past 200 years, as our country has grown from strength to strength, drawing on our native dynamism and the ancient ideals of Western civilization, democracy has taken root in so many other parts of the world. Just 6 years after the signing of the Treaty of Paris, France began writing its own proud chapter in the history of liberty. Our English cousins, too, continue to evolve and expand their free parliamentary institutions. Perhaps the greatest tribute of all is the fact that today, all the signatory nations of the Paris Treaty are themselves democracies, staunch friends and allies of the United States, sharing our dedication to peace and freedom. So this bicentennial is not just a great event for America. It's a time of celebration and rededication for all peoples who cherish our ideals and who've contributed to them here and around the world. And I'm particularly glad that we can share this moment with the representatives of England and France,
And I also want to add a special word of thanks to Congressman Herb Bateman, who introduced this legislation, and to Senator Mac Mathias and Representatives Marjorie Holt, Bill Bromfield, and Clint Zablocki and other members, Clem Zablocki and other members who've done so much to make this celebration possible. And I thank you for sharing this memorable moment with us here at the White House. And now to borrow a phrase, oh, I couldn't resist this. I am going to put my John Hancock into this historic piece of legislation. Thank you, and God bless you all.